Just hang on to the thought, because I want to play off this, what you were talking about doing damage. Just say, for instance, in a hypothetical world in some other parallel universe, that Trump is not reelected for another term. How much of the damage that John's talking about, how much of that damage is going to be permanent, or maybe at least long-term? And how much can be recovered by the next president, whoever that might be, within a very short period of time?
Joseph a raison, je crois qu'il y a une continuité dans la politique américaine, c'est tout à fait évident, et que le style un peu particulier de Trump nous le fait oublier, mais il y a tout à fait une continuité dans la politique américaine. Je suis d'accord que le grand changement, c'est l'abandon du néoconservatisme aux États-Unis, cette doctrine qui considère que la justice ou que la démocratie est plus importante que la paix, ça c'est fini. Aujourd'hui, on est revenu au réalisme metternichien ou kissingerien. La paix, c'est ce qui est le plus important. Je crois qu'il y a un héritage, legacy, comme on dit en anglais, un héritage de Trump qui va rester, qui est très important. C'est quand même le premier qui a dit, il l'a dit à Davos, et personne ne l'avait dit avant lui. Pas un président de la Commission européenne ne l'avait dit. Pas un président américain ne l'avait dit. Il a dit extrêmement clairement, et c'est le premier à l'avoir dit, « Messieurs les Chinois, arrêtez de voler la technologie. » C'est très important. Et il a d'ailleurs un soutien bipartisan là-dessus, et nous avons eu, jusqu'à Trump, nous avons eu des présidents américains qui ont été extrêmement, on dit en anglais, complacent, extrêmement indulgents à l'égard de la Chine, y compris Obama. Je veux simplement vous rappeler que quand Xi Jinping est venu aux États-Unis, dans une conférence de presse, il a été interrogé sur le fait que les Chinois avaient accaparé les récifs des îlots Paracel et Spratleys en mer de Chine méridionale. Et là, Xi Jinping a répondu publiquement, oui, mais il a promis que jamais il ne militariserait ces îlots. Aujourd'hui, nous avons des bombardiers stratégiques chinois avec des grandes pistes et des missiles sur 6 ou 7 de ces îlots qui sont, en droit international, des terrae nullius, des terres qui n'appartiennent à personne, et la Chine ne reconnaît pas, qui prétend pourtant être attachée au multilatéralisme, ne reconnaît pas l'autorité ou la décision de la Cour permanente d'arbitrage de La Haye sur cette mer de Chine, sur la possession de cette mer de Chine méridionale. Donc ça va être vraiment, à mon avis, l'héritage principal de Trump. Alors, sa politique étrangère, elle est extrêmement simple, et ça a été dit, c'est toute sa politique étrangère, et il reste 55 semaines avant l'élection, ça va être tourné vers qu'est-ce qui peut me faire réélire. Mon argumentation, moi je suis Trump, mon argumentation à l'égard d'un électorat américain qui n'est pas le plus sophistiqué du monde, il faut le reconnaître, il est très simple. Il va dire, grâce à moi, avant on entrait comme dans un moulin en Amérique, avec moi c'est fini. Même si ce n'est pas vrai, peu importe. Le ressenti, parce qu'en politique ce qui compte ce n'est pas la vérité, c'est le ressenti. Les gens diront, oui c'est vrai. C'est vrai qu'il a protégé les frontières, il a combattu l'immigration clandestine. Ensuite, il dira, mes détracteurs pendant la campagne électorale ont dit, c'est vrai, vous aviez des tas d'articles dans le New York Times, de Stiglitz et autres, qui vous expliquaient que si Trump est élu, ça serait une catastrophe absolue pour l'économie américaine. Il dit, non, jamais la situation n'a été meilleure, et n'a été meilleure pour les classes défavorisées, pour les Noirs et les Hispaniques, qui n'ont jamais connu de meilleurs salaires et n'ont jamais connu de meilleurs taux d'emploi. Et
John Quad is shaking his head yes here. I think he's.
I agree with him. 100%. I agree.
Non, mais c'est la campagne qui va faire. Il faut, yeah. faut être réaliste.
Mais c'est la réalité.
Voilà. Et la troisième chose. Donc il va dire, j'ai été un bon ministre de l'Intérieur. J'ai été un bon ministre de l'Économie. Il lui reste une dernière chose. Il faut qu'il montre qu'il a été un bon ministre des Affaires étrangères. Et ça, il cherche. C'est pour ça qu'il cherche un deal, quelque chose qui soit médiatique, qui peuvent être vendus, parce qu'évidemment, l'apparence est tout dans le Trumpisme. Et alors, il y a l'Iran, c'est pour ça qu'il a été tenté par la proposition Macron à New York. Il y a la Corée, mais effectivement, dans l'exécution, il n'a pas été très bon, et je ne suis pas sûr que les Coréens veulent vraiment un deal. Il lui faut quelque chose. Peut-être qu'il va l'obtenir avec la Chine, mais il faut aussi que le jour de l'élection, il dit, regardez, je suis aussi un grand diplomate. Et ça suffira, je pense, que ça suffira s'il arrive à réunir toujours ces trois conditions. Je pense que ça peut suffire à le faire réélire.
So a future president should preserve some of the things that Trump has done. John Paul,
I wanted to say two things very briefly. And that was first in reaction to what John was saying, but Renaud touched on that. If you look at the polls, and I don't necessarily believe the polls, all polls are negative and show Trump losing against any Democratic candidate. And his perception from the electorate, again, I mean, if you believe at the poll and so far ahead of the election, 55 weeks, but there's one element on which he's always better, he's doing well for the economy. The Americans, the majority of the Americans said he's doing well for the economy and the job situation has improved. Now, I agree with you, he needs something else. He needs something more. Is he going to get it? That's a big question. But the reality is that, and again, the question is not so much whether he's going to get reelected on his own merit. The question to me is more, and we touch on that, and I agree with you. I think Biden is toast, as we said in America, for a variety of reasons. I don't think it has to do with the story of his surviving son or anything. I think it has to do with the perception that when people, somebody said yesterday, you need to be 80 years old to be president of the United States now. And I think it's a very good comment. You know, it used to be true for China, now it's unfortunately true for the United States. Mm. So we are in a situation, the people, it was true in 2006, it's not just in the United States. Unfortunately, in modern democracies, we don't vote for someone. We vote against someone. When I voted in 2016, it's not secret, I said it publicly, I voted against Trump, and I voted against Hillary Clinton, and I voted for a candidate who had no chance of getting elected, but got 4 million votes, Gary Johnson. No, my point is that in 2016, 7 million Americans voted for somebody else than Clinton or Trump. This time, the question is going to be, we don't like Trump, we don't like his tweets, and I hear it all the time from my Republican friends. But at the same time, they'll look, who's going to be the nominee of the Democratic Party? Too early to say. Elizabeth Warren, Bernie Sanders had a heart problem. I wish him well. Elizabeth Warren has a good chance of being the nominee. And the Boko Hunters, as you said, and the rest is going to come out. And it's going to be an easy campaign. And Trump can be extremely nasty. And he will be very nasty. And he will get a lot of support for that. So, I mean, I'm not saying it's going to work. But the reality is, at the end of the day, people are not going to vote for somebody. They're going to vote against someone. And they will say, what's worse, having 4 more years with damaging consequences? I agree. That's real. And that could be serious. At the same time, do we want Medicare for all? Or do we want the Green New Deal? Which is something totally crazy. I mean, I believe in the environment, but the Green New Deal, if you have not read about it, heard about it, please study it.
We've got to bring Moto into this.
Okay.
So
let me just come back to your original question, right? Whether there's going to be a change in international system, yeah, with or without Trump. Mm. Now, first, we have to remember when Mr. Trump started the trade war with China, the main issue was the trade deficit and tariffs and protection of some industries. But now, the much more important issue you just mentioned, the intellectual property or forced technology transfer. Mm-hmm. And so, not only just Mr. Trump, many people in the United States is critical against China. So that may take some more time. And then big question is, when China entered WTO in 2001, the size of the Chinese economy is only 1/10 of present size. So in the last 10 years, China become very, very big. And big question is, can these two big economy coexist under the present umbrella of the WTO? And it seems to be very difficult. So not only the behavior change of China and the United States, which may be necessary for convergence, but we have to thinking about more realistic international system. Unfortunately, we don't know any very clear picture, but that is exactly the point. I mean, the trilemma, when you have some kind of globalization, then you need some kind of change of the system in order to sustain the system.
All right, I want to try something. I didn't, it's a little bit of a surprise for you because I hadn't briefed you on any of this, but I think one of the things I'd like to ask you, because you're all very highly placed in your various societies and political systems, what do you think your prime minister or president, what do you think that the people around them, the foreign ministers and whatnot, find the most annoying about Mr. Trump? And maybe at the same time, the thing they find most agreeable about dealing with Mr. Trump. John, why don't we start with you? Got any ideas?
Okay, well, the first thing I'd say is that in terms of the British relationship with America, as Joseph would say, 90% of it is unchanged. Mm-hmm. The only thing that gets changed are things that touch the White House. And as most of us know who've worked in government, actually relatively few issues go to the head of government. Most of them are sorted out at a bureaucratic or institutional departmental level. Certainly, the intelligence cooperation between Britain and America hasn't changed at all, despite Trump's unreliability on intelligence and his degree of disregard or contempt for America's intelligence agencies. So life goes on, and heads of government, they dominate the media. You guys got lovely stories out of Trump, but actually life does go on as normal. And the great thing, in many ways, if you want to do regular business with the United States, keep it away from heads of government. Keep it away from Trump.
But unreliable would be one of the words you would think of, though.
He's unpredictable. He takes decisions based on prejudices and preconceived ideas. He doesn't try to educate himself. Now, Obama was the opposite extreme. He educated himself so much that he didn't take decisions.
Right.
But Trump, you get decisions instantly without caring what the consequences of them are. It's just gut instinct as to what his base is going to welcome.
Sean, what about Xi? What do you think he finds, the people around him, what do they find most annoying about Mr. Trump?
Let me first back to the question you asked, with or without Trump,
right, okay.
Is anything changing in terms of relation between China and the U.S.? I don't think it will be a substantial change without Trump. As many people say in past 2 days, there's a fundamental difference between these two countries. So only thing may be changing is the focus may be changing from trade to maybe human rights, or the style will be changing. The substantial tension, I guess, will be persistent for a long, long time. That's my things. For Chinese side, I don't think they are very much interested in internal politics in United States, because that's something nothing to do with us. Of course, doesn't mean they don't look closely. Of course, they don't.
Because this trade deal, as you said, is going to support Trump electorally and domestically.
Yeah, they look at it closely, but nothing to do for China in these kind of things.
Right.
Can I just add a point on the trade deal? My sense in American politics is that there's a trade-off for Trump and the Republicans as to whether you go for a short-term benefit of selling soybeans to China, or whether you can position yourself politically as being tough on China. And I think Trump is much more comfortable being tough on China in the debate over the next year than he is getting some short-term economic kick, because he doesn't need that short-term economic kick. What he doesn't want is for a Democratic candidate, and whoever it may be, it's far too early, I think, to say who the Democratic candidate is going to be. He doesn't want to be outflanked and looked as though he's soft on China, because that would be electorally damaging for him, including in his own base.
Yeah. I mean, except that, you know, as we've been talking about, he is taking the short-term gain on the agricultural deal, because
he wants both, not only one.
But it's not, he's giving up on fundamental change of China, because it's not a Chinese economy, because it's not attainable. So he's just going for fiddling with the balance of payments and the trade deficit, which will make him look good.
Let me shift a little bit the discussion. It is quite clear that Trump is the bull in the China shop. And he's a pretty bad bull, because the normal bull doesn't know what he's doing, because it's by his very weight and strength that he demolishes stuff. Trump loves to demolish the store. He loves to demolish and deconstruct the global system the United States built 70 years ago and kept maintaining, which served American interests, and it served the interests of others too. So here he is rampaging through the China store, demolishing stuff. And what puzzles me is, how come there is so little reaction on the part of the rest of the world? Normally, if somebody unhinges the system and exerts brutal power, you would have balance of power behavior. The rest of the world would gang up against the bull to tame him. How come this is not happening?
Well, that's a good question. And you know, you see this accommodation being made, and we talk about bilateral agreements as opposed to multilateral organizations and that sort of thing. But there hasn't been that much pushback on a multilateral
level. Look at the Europeans. Yeah. Yesterday, certainly we're not. Are we rearming? No. The share of GDP devoted to defense is actually going down again. Are the three great powers, France, Britain, and Germany, doing something to take up the slack? Well, last year, the mighty German U-boat force, consisting of six U-boats, had six out of operation. And so you can go on and on and on. This is what puzzles me. Why aren't, I mean, Europe, 500 million people, a GDP bigger than China's, enormous resources. How come, maybe you guys can tell me, how come Europe doesn't create a counterweight to this raging bull?
There's one answer to that, Joseph.
Okay, of course, there are probably many.
And that is that many of the issues that Trump and Lighthizer have raised with the Chinese are actually shared by Europeans. Okay. The unlevel playing field for foreign businesses in China, endless state subsidies for Chinese enterprises, the rapacious demands for technology transfer or for buying up technology. So many of the issues which Trump, in his clumsy, rather brutal way, is addressing.
So he's our leader.
But he's not a leader we're comfortable with, because we don't agree with his tactics. We don't agree with the damage he's doing to the world trade system. But we do agree with many of the specifics he's raising about China. Just as we know, a lot of us agree with his pressures on Germany and Italy and other European countries to raise their defense spending. So he fastens on to some relevant issues, and then he would naturally have support if only he sought that support. But he alienates that support because of the way he goes about it.
It's just not about China. It's about tons of other things. For instance, freedom of navigation in the Gulf. So apparently he doesn't pay that much attention to it. He accepts one provocation after another from Tehran. And do we see the French and the Brits and the Germans mount a flotilla to protect freedom of the seas in the Gulf?
Well, so that is happening to a certain extent. There are British and French ships there.
Do you know how many major surface combatants the two countries have? About two dozen each.
Well,
they used to have 250.
But
like
it doesn't take much to deter an Iranian attack on a commercial.
Really?
If you've got the, you know, we've seen that happen.
Yeah. Example?
Before we get to Jean-Claude, Renaud is here. And we don't like to stifle his comments because...
Non, très, très, très. Si les Européens, pour répondre à Joseph, si les Européens ne réagissent pas face à ce que vous appelez la brutalité de Trump, c'est parce qu'ils ont aussi quand même, dans l'espace et dans le temps, des modèles un peu plus brutaux que Donald Trump. Alors, dans l'espace, Je ne sais pas si on ne peut pas dire que Poutine n'est pas un peu quand même plus brutal que Donald Trump. Je ne sais pas si on peut pas dire. On peut peut-être dire que Xi Jinping est plus brutal que Donald Trump. Et dans l'espace et dans le temps, ils ont quand même l'exemple de George W. Bush qui était plus brutal que Donald Trump. Donc ça, à mon avis, c'est la raison pour laquelle ils ne réagissent pas. Mais n'oubliez pas, on l'a dit, qu'en fait, Trump, il invite les Européens à réagir. Parce que qui est-ce qui a dit avant vous aux Européens de se... Avant Joseph, il y a quelqu'un qui a dit aux Européens de se réarmer. C'est Donald Trump. Donc, si vous voulez, voilà la réponse à votre question. Pourquoi est-ce que les Européens réagissent si peu?
Okay, so, John, well, okay, very quickly, because we're down into the...
No, it's going to be very quick. On these more fundamental issues with China, I think I mentioned it the other day during a Q&A session. The CFIUS process, which is the Council for Foreign Investment in the United States, which is the, all the agencies getting together and approving acquisition by Chinese companies and other part of the world, but it's mostly Chinese, has been very, very strictly reinforced, strengthened, and so on and so forth, and to the point that now many transactions don't even try to be approved because they know they won't get approved. So this is a way to protect some of the American intellectual properties against China.
My point, Jean-Claude, is the same has happened in Britain, the same has happened in France and Germany. Right. The European Union is producing a regulation to do very much what CFIUS is doing, and Japan has produced the most rigorous regulations, more rigorous than the United States, to prevent Chinese ownership of even a small proportion of Japanese technology companies.
So but John, to answer on this. John, what the problem is the fact those initiatives are not coordinated.
Yeah.
Well, and we would be more efficient if we were coordinated. I take the blame for the Americans.
Well, that is my point about the damage that Trump has done to alliances, is that you've ended up with a fragmented response to this problem rather than a concerted response to it.